I always knew that there was something. It was kind of a niggling thing in the back of my mind. But the problem was no one could figure out what it was.
Yeah, it's scary. It's scary and it's frightening and it's unknown.
It was literally a hole in the head. Make foolish people do. My name's Helen and I'm Ben's mum. Ben was born on the 15th of March 1999 and it was one of the best days of my life. But he had this runny nose and he would always be wiping it and he'd end the day with a huge wet patch on his arm.
We also noticed that his upper lip was always glistening and always wet. So we went to doctors and said, obviously this lad has a very, very abnormally dribbly nose.
So he was about 9 months old when the symptoms first started. And the first person I took him to was our GP at the time, whose classic answer or question to every problem was, how is he within himself? And because he was such a happy baby, I said fine, and the doctor sent us away, essentially. A couple of days later, the ear, nose and throat surgeon rang me and said that the test was actually positive for brain fluid. The liquid that had been coming out of Ben's nostril on and off since he was 9 months old was brain fluid. The scary thing was we didn't know what it meant other than that it was serious.
When the test came back from the university saying that brain fluid was leaking out of my son's nose, it's fair to say there was a bit of a panic.
Complete shock to me and to Andrew and our wider family.
They sent Ben off immediately for a CAT scan. And the CAT scan revealed that he had a hole in the base of his skull and that went into his nasal cavity. And through that, his brain membrane had actually oozed out, and then it was like a sump, and bits of brain material was gathering in there. So in effect, they realized immediately that his brain was hanging out basically in the open air at the top of his nose.
Ben's literally bouncing on the bed and a doctor walks into the room. I remember this quite vividly and said, your child has some of his brain up his nostril. Hello, my name's Colin Barber.
My name is Colin Barber. I'm a ENT surgeon, but a paediatric ENT surgeon, so I only operate on children. ENT is ear, nose and throat surgery. When your brain forms, it forms and it gets enclosed inside the skull. So we have a hard bit of skull on the outside, but there's also a hard floor to the skull as well. So somewhere along the line, in the making of the floor of your skull, so the inside, the top, underneath your, above your eyes and into your nose, that part of the skull didn't close. So a portion of your brain decided to wander down and live inside your nose. The concern is that if you're dripping out bits of your CSF into your nose is a bit of a mucky place. I mean, we all get colds regularly, and certainly small children get lots and lots of colds. So the concern is that you're going to end up getting meningitis, because it's an easy route for bugs to go from your snotty old nose up into your brain. So I operated in conjunction with the neurosurgeon. You can't just cut it off in the nose, because you're going to leave a great big hole. So we have to work with the neurosurgeons to open up the skull to not only take out what's in the nose, but also make a covering inside the floor of the skull to stop any more bits of brain falling out.
So then it was all ding, 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 ding. We've got to get him into hospital. We've got to operate. We've got to close this up. Anything could happen.
We tried to explain to him as best we could that he was going to go into hospital and have what we described to him as a special sleep, and they were going to fix his runny nose.
The day of the operation dawned, and we went in there, and remember, Ben's only two. So that meant that Mum and Dad could actually accompany him right up to the operating table, which is quite extreme, really. Often you just wave goodbye to your loved ones at a door and they go, bye, and then they go and they do the pre-op and they do the operation. But the day we went in, both Helen and I ended up in the pre-operation room as the first drugs were given to Ben.
And then I was allowed into the theatre where they administered the gas to make him go to sleep prior to surgery.
The people came by with the consent forms. This is saying, you know, do you consent to us, you know, opening up a hole in your son's skull, shrinking his brain, cutting bits off, and then pasting it all back together again? And if anything goes wrong, do you consent that we'll, you know, resuscitate him and do whatever is needed?
When they said that, I was physically incapable of signing that consent form, permitting my son's life to be put in the hands of other people and out of my control.
You start reading this thing and Helen can't sign it. So I signed that one. And then I saw being lifted up by Mum and then just carried through the doors. And I went, and I turned and walked out of the pre-op room to a lift, and I was all alone in a corridor, and I just burst into tears, gales of tears, floods of tears.
The surgeons reassured us that if anything happened during the surgery, they would ring. So we then had a long wait.
We can help no more. And so Helen and I are out and about downstairs.
And it was, I felt every second of it. It was the longest day in my life. So we thought we had a 5-hour period of time in which to fill. We went for a walk around the domain, had a coffee in Grafton, you know, lay under a big tree in the domain and looked up at the clouds.
And we wandered around the domain, and then every now and then we'd try and forget what was happening. It's out of our control. But every now and then we'd look at it and go, look at the watch and go, 2 hours.
Wanted to stay nearby to the hospital.
3 hours, stop looking at the watch.
And it got harder and harder because we didn't know what was going on. The only comfort that we had was that we hadn't had any phone call.
4 hours 30.
Walking around the museum and waiting. 5 hours came and went.
5 hours, let's go. We walk in, we get pipe, pipe, pipe. Told that it would take 5 hours. What's happening? Oh, we don't know. Let's go and see. For the next 2 hours, we were told nothing. That Ben didn't come through the doors. Now you can imagine what's going through our minds. We're thinking, Christ, so it's supposed to take 5 hours. Why is it now 6 hours? Something's going wrong. Something's happened to Ben.
Freaky kind of time then, because I couldn't function at all. My body completely closed down, almost like I was going to go to sleep. I just was not able to do anything other than breathe. Probably about 8 hours after we said goodbye to Ben, we were able to say hello to him again. There he was, all wrapped up.
Bandaged head, blood.
And pipes and tubes and all sorts coming out of various parts of his body.
Anyway, eventually a doctor came out and said, yeah, we're finished. And we went, what the hell went wrong? It's been 7 hours. And he went, Oh no, the operation, the procedure took 5 hours. And what they'd completely forgotten to tell us is it takes an hour to prep them and to put them under and to anaesthetize them and to get all the bits and pieces in place. And it also takes an hour to monitor his signs as he comes out of the deep general anaesthesia. So yes, the procedure took 5 hours, but the operation was always scheduled for 7. So those 2 hours of just the worst 2 hours of our lives, to be honest.
To reassure us, the surgeon asked Ben to poke out his tongue, which he duly did. Clever boy. Ben had one or two nights in the high dependency unit of the paediatric neurosurgery ward, but he recovered very, very quickly from his surgery.
He's getting more and more rambunctious. He's a two-year-old.
Before long, he was literally running up and down the corridors of the neurosurgery ward to the point where they had to ask if we were happy for him to be discharged early, because the reality of the matter was that there were actually kids in that ward who were a lot sicker than Ben. We were lucky, but it was time to take him home.
Sense of smell is one of the oldest parts of the brain, and a part of the brain passes forward just to the very top part of your nose. So most of your nose you use for breathing through to go down into your lungs, but the very top part you use for smelling. So the bit between your eyes is where a portion of the brain comes forward, and you've got actually part of the brain and a few little neurons picking up the sense of smell. But of course, when we're operating in that front part of the brain where you had a bit of a defect, the senses, it is possible that we could injure your sense of smell.
I asked them, well, how do we know if he's got a sense of smell? And Colin said, well, you can't test for that sort of thing. You'll just find out over time. We were walking to the beach and we walked past a fish and chip shop.
And he goes, have we got fish and chips? I smell fish and chips. And Helen and I looked at each other and just went, can it be?
That was a really precious moment for us as a family, where we knew that, you know, he'll be able to taste and smell things. Made us really happy, even if it was fish and chips.
Gonna rule my room sometimes. Gonna